Good morning. After all this mayhem, I'm Henriette Rahussen. Worked with Jim on French-Dutch economic issues, but always did a lot of art history, and as you will see today, this will be a blend of history and art history. I currently work 3 days a week at the National Gallery of Art in the Department of Dutch and Flemish Old Master Paintings, so it's a great job. It has some bearing on history because I do quite a bit of research, but I'm having a lot of fun, and that's the most important part. So, Jim's latest book, La Monarchie Républicaine. The moment that the issue for Call of Papers came, I thought I have to be able to figure something out in the relation to the Dutch, flip it around, and I'm gonna show you the monarchical aspirations of the very republican Dutch in the 17th century. In Jim's book, he talks about the consequences of the hyper-personalized political system of the 17th and 18th century in France and the intermingling of the public and private interests as they relate to the public debt. And you can just switch out the words France and switch over to the Netherlands, and you have the same issues. So the same is true, especially for the States General of the Republic, which consists of delegates from the seven provinces that were united in their revolt against Spanish overlordship. But within that federalized system of the seven provinces, there was enormous competition over issues of power, who had the biggest voice. And so despite the fact that they were called united, they were pretty much disunited provinces as far as the reality is concerned. Throughout the early modern period, starting with the beginning of the revolt, the province of Holland with Amsterdam as its economic motor was by far the most powerful, both in economic and thus in political terms. And why do I say thus? Because the city's delegates to the provincial states and the provincial states' delegates to the States General had the biggest voice by the sheer force of their economic power relating to paying more than half over the whole period of the revenue of the federal system. So the central role of taxation is also, of course, close to Jim's heart from the very beginning. And the first book that Jim had me read as a graduate student, and knowing that I am Dutch, as you can, of course, hear, the first book he had me read was Pieter Lacour's The True Interest and Political Maxims of Holland, issued in 1662, much later in the process of the development of the Dutch state, but at the height of the republican fervor within the Netherlands, and at the height of the argument that you need to be a free people with self-governance, and you cannot let yourself be hoodwinked by a single monarchical princely ruler. And of course, the Dutch were very much constantly debating over the powers of the princes of Orange, who were from the olden days titular stadtholders. They had the highest office in several of the provinces in Holland, and over the course of the revolt, because of their job as commanders-in-chief, some of them very capable, they gained more and more political credibility, so their aspirations grew as well. But as Lacour say, you have to make sure that they don't arrogate power to themselves, because then the true freedom is in trouble. Now this is a fictive painting, because you cannot have the four generations alive posing for the same picture at the same time. But we have Prince William the Silent, the first, who was the first leader of the revolt, his son Maurits, Maurits's half-brother Frederick Hendrik, Frederick Hendrik's son Willem II, and the only one not in armor, the young Willem III, more of which later. So the true interest of the Netherlands was to keep these guys maybe at hand in case of military problems, but definitely keep them away from power, which was easier said than done, especially in the active years of the revolt, when Spanish and Dutch forces were very much engaged in active warfare under the leadership of Maurits of Nassau, and on the Republican side, Johan van Oldenbarneveldt, officially the highest functionary of the province of Holland, but by the sheer fact of Holland's preeminence, the leading statesman in the Netherlands. He was the one who got everybody together to establish the Dutch East India Company in 1602, which led to the booming economy. And he was the one who really pulled the provincial states together in the States General. So, early in the century, Maurits and Oldenbarneveldt, who had started off working together against Spain, increasingly started to clash over preeminence in the in society. Lots of issues, including major religious strife between the Orthodox and less Orthodox Calvinist arrives. But it culminates in 1619 with the trial instigated by Prince Maurits of the 72-year-old Oldenbarneveldt, who has a very pretty much quickie trial, treason because he was too much in the pocket of the French, and his head is chopped off. Now, what is fascinating in Dutch history, even as kids, what you learn about van Oldenbarneveldt is that when he mounted the scaffold, he was leaning on his walking stick, and the walking stick became a symbol of steadfastness against tyrannical rule, and even the walking stick became highly celebrated. There are several authentic walking sticks in circulation. I don't know, the true cross is also multiplied several times, but this is the walking stick that was in the estate of his son Reinier, so we could be fairly sure that this is the true walking stick. So that led me in the visual realm to the importance of the walking stick in Dutch art. And from the early days, you start to see full-length portraits of Dutch burghers, not aristocrats, not royalty, with walking sticks. So I thought, okay, my paper is done. I'm going to show you the Republican symbolism of the walking stick in Dutch art. And I am, I think, bolstered by the fact that if you look at, this is from the database of the Dutch art, whatever they call themselves in English, Dutch Institute for Art History. 1580, 1689, the appearance of walking sticks in Dutch art. And then if you break that, I didn't do this, this was all their database. If you then break down that same period, you see that the height of walking stick fame is in the middle of that period. So I think the data confirm my hypothesis. And I will quickly scroll through some of the multiple slides that are available. National hero Admiral Piet Hein of Silver Fleet fame, notable from the province of Frisia, especially notable, apart from his walking stick, for the decorations on his shoes. Jim, you should really
pretty soon I'm going to need the walking stick.
In the mid-40s, when the revolt is moving toward its negotiated conclusion, we have a series of militia portraits, including the Night Watch, but this one in particular, we have the two leaders of the division with their walking sticks, and even artists got into the game because Gerard Douw portrays himself leaning on a table but having his walking stick at hand. So, okay, proof that the walking stick is important for blah blah blah. Okay, but in the process of looking for my walking sticks, I come across this amazing pamphlet print from 1608. This was in the middle of the negotiations between the Dutch and the Spaniards, assisted by the French over peace, possible peace. Who is in the center of this? Oh, and the it's the Dutch fighting the Spanish over preeminence in East Asia, the spice trade. But who is standing in the center of this image, watching this this battle going on? None other than Henri Quatre. And with Pierre Janin, the French ambassador to the Netherlands in this period, active participant in the negotiations, whispering in his ear. So now my theory is shot, because here you have a very much monarchical example of somebody leaning on his walking stick. So, okay, so I had to continue. Now, this one is in a little bit, so I move from the Dutch Republic to the French monarchy, because this is interesting. Henry IV in 1592, he must have been really sick, because he looks awful, but he's leaning on his walking stick. This is a bad image, I couldn't find a better one, but posing again majestically, but using the walking stick. Another one by Purbus. The famous appearance of the walking stick in the Medici cycle. First in Henry being completely bowled over by the image of Marie. And then leaning on his stick when she arrives in Marseille later on. So what's up with Henry and the walking stick? Two options. Either he, as a Basque, is leaning on what is known as the maquila, which is in Basque country a symbol of authority and justice and strength. So he's going back to his roots and using the stick. Or he is channeling Charles V, whose scepter from the 14th century is clearly full length to the floor. That's a question for you French historians, but the image of a long stick of power was there for Henry to use. A quick side note, why do I think it is Janin? Pretty much he was there, he was a lawyer, and the images of Janin pretty much prove that, yes, that was him in the print. This person is interesting because this is Maurits, 1608. So who is the very prominent gentleman over there leaning on his walking stick? Well, in 1608, Maurits was not yet the Prince of Orange, because his older brother Philip Willem was very much alive as the Prince of Orange. But he had been taken hostage much earlier and had been raised at the Spanish court in Spain. But by the time of the negotiations, they had allowed him to start being present in the southern Netherlands again. And this portrait dates exactly from that time. And Philips Willem is leaning on his walking stick. So the French assist the Dutch pressuring the Spaniards. Yes, we have a truce of 12 years. Then it becomes even more fun, because with Henry IV and his walking sticks, we then have to say, okay, what's going on further? Louis XIII loved his walking sticks. His sister Henrietta Maria marries Charles I, and Charles adopts the attribute of his father-in-law. And famous paintings on both sides of the channel, Charles I, the pose of, or the imagery behind these two, I still have to figure out what the relationship is. Charles II as a little boy. And the reason that I'm going back to this is we have to turn our way back to the Princess of Orange. And luckily for the Princess of Orange, in the young William II marries the daughter of Charles I. So Prince William II is brother-in-law to both Charles II and James II. Short stick, no walking stick for the Princess of Orange. Maybe the times had changed a little bit and he, anyway. I'm getting somewhere. William II does a very unpopular move. He tries to get into Amsterdam by force. So the Republican Dutch close the gates and are extremely unhappy with him, and smallpox strikes him a couple of months later, leaving Princess Mary Stuart pregnant of little William. And the Dutch say, no stadtholders, no power for this little prince, forget about it. As a youngster, he is married to the daughter of James II. And James and Mary, who are full cousins, or cousins once removed, end up being called to the throne of England by the English after the upheavals of the 17th century there, and become William and Mary of Mary and William's college fame, William and Mary College fame. So, when they ascend the throne, Willem III leaves the Netherlands in 1689, happily becomes a king, and they have reached their goal. The Dutch princes of Orange have become royals. Right at that moment in 1889 is when the walking stick phase disappears, and I have to then finish the lineup of the, so these two guys are the great-grandchildren both of Henri Quatre. But Uncle Louis is still in Paris. He doesn't sport the long walking stick, but likes the short scepter, but he likes long legs, apparently. He and William III, or William of the Netherlands, were in a lifelong battle power, and the English King William II triumphs over the French king, is a later sealing illustration. So we have the two great-grandchildren of Henry II crushing the power of the symbolized Louis XIV. He's holding a short scepter. This is William's scepter, and there is Mary. So England becomes a monarchie républicaine. The Dutch have their royal prince of King of Orange, and the circle is pretty much around, and it is a little excursion into a tiny symbol in art that can bring a lot of pleasure. One last thing about Peter de la Cour, our Republican pundit in the middle of the century, relating to what is happening both in France tomorrow and in the Netherlands over these past couple of weeks. The true interests of Holland in 62, freedom of toleration, plenary freedom for anybody in the country. Counter to that, a Dutch parliamentarian in 2017 who has realized that the Dutch schools have forbidden the Easter cross in their schools because otherwise it would offend Muslims. He tweets, no Christian cross anymore, not to offend Muslims, and in Trumpian style he says, unacceptable. So, he should read Pierre de Lacour. I don't think he has. Thank you very much.